being here. Thank you for the invitation from Eva to talk, and thank you for putting up my PowerPoint. It's always nice to speak at this conference and also to tell you more about this project as it's evolved. And apologies for missing this morning, but I'm singing nursery rhymes and other things with my kids. Anyway, I'm trying to get into mode of professional talking. Here we go. I should say, on the back of David's very interesting talk there on some of the work we did earlier in the year, we're moving on to year three to conserve these stones. So part of our budget is actually looking to prioritise conservation of those that are in particular danger, and some of them may need to be re-erected as well to keep it safe because they're strained. So that's a bit of an aside. Well, here we are. This is the first slide. I thought I'd start with this. It's an impressive sight and hopefully whet your appetite. I always like this photo. Shows some of our volunteers who've been involved in our big dig this year. I'm going to be telling you mainly about our community excavation that took place in August, which was at Lochore Castle in Fife. There we go. So yes, the story continues. We were here last year to tell you about our dig and various other activities were going on. We're now moved into the final year. So at the end of the talk, I'll give you a sense of any of this whets your appetite, what other events that you can get involved with as well. And also, crucially, we're looking to deliver all the data that we've been discovering as well and celebrate what we've been doing. But back to year two, we've been having a lot of fun, really. I often think professional archaeologists forget that we probably got into this because it's quite good fun and really interesting. So we've been using this project to engage people mainly by enjoying themselves. And yes, some of us get very wet and cold sometimes as well, must be said. But they're still smiling and talking to me. And so here's David on one of the boundary stone surveys. Been having some medieval fun at Lochore. And a lot of volunteers have been involved. We've got a lot of return volunteers this year. So we're booked out in most of our events, but we had 40 separate volunteers joining us, and this year alone about 1,200 volunteer hours accumulated. And with our workshops and guided tours and the like, and David's been doing some tours for school pupils as well, we've had 165 secondary school pupils and primary school pupils involved from across the parts of Fife that we're working in, so around the Falkland, Leslie and Benarty Lochore areas. And this is really what we started the year with, apart from looking for our boundary stones, was the follow-on from last year. So we've been doing a series of post-excavation workshops, and we've been doing these in collaboration with creative artists and writers as well, including Jan Henry, who you can see here. So we did on the back of our East Lomond big dig at the Pictish Hill Fort on East Lomond Hill above Falkland. Falkland Hill, sometimes referred to. Pictish simple stone workshops, so not only teaching the kids about who the Picts were, what type of society they had, choosing their own name as a Pict and their identity in their society, creating these prints, rather lovely prints, and some of them being recreated in plaster by Penny Sinclair, another local artist. So that's a lot of fun. And here's their final banner, which they produced. There's three stones of Bob Leslie, Falkland and Newton of Falkland as well, and they produce these rather lovely banners that have been on display at a variety of our events as well. But the mainstay of what we're talking about is here's our boundary stones David's been talking about. So this is the project area. And I just want to plug Mike Arrowsmith, who's been doing some photogrammetry work for this to create three-dimensional models of stones. One of the things we're doing as part of the conservation effort is modelling some of the boundary stones. And Mike is going to be showing some of his other work at the end of my talk briefly. But the mainstay of the work we've been doing this year is down at the other end of our project area, which is the Lochore, Ballingarry, Benarty and Croxhill area. This is an old mining community, and it's fair to say that our project is a wide gradient in employment opportunities and wealth and access to education, etc. And in this area, we were really keen to engage as many people as we could, because it's not necessarily an area that we had a lot of engagement at the beginning of our project. So this is where the dig took place, is within Lochore Meadows Country Park. And this, as I suggested earlier, is quite a different landscape. Since the 19th century, there's been at least six deep coal mines in this area. And it's really kind of struck the recent history of that area and affected the landscape in a great way. And the park itself has grown out of a very large land reclamation project, probably one of the largest in Europe at the time, in the 60s, and is now a leisure facility for people, very cherished leisure facility. But what it's done is it's trashed a lot of the historic landscape there, which makes quite incredible why this has survived. This is the tower of Lochore Castle coming out of the vegetation here. And this is it last year at the entrance to the park. And after some great effort from our local groups and college students, it's been cleared and we've now been able to really assess exactly what we've got. It's a scheduled monument. Obviously, it's been known as a very important site for a long time. Eddie Henderson, the local historian in particular, has done a lot of work on this, with Geoffrey Barrow's written on the history of the barony, which was focused around this seat. But it's given us access to do a lot of things. I'm just going to tell you a brief bit about the history, for those of you who don't know the site. This is it on an etching from 1770 by John Clare of Eldon. And as you can see, it used to be on an island, which is one of the most striking things to know about the site to begin with. And that's obviously to do with its more recent history of drainage in the area. But as you can see, it's a significant fortification. And we'll just flip over to this copy done by Cardonnell a decade or so later. And you can see we have a large central keep with a surrounding barnkin wall and these corner towers. Interior ranges visible on the inside. But there's been a great deal of damage done to the site subsequent to those illustrations, obviously. So the background of the family history of the site, many of these castles, obviously castles have lordships of dynasties associated with them. Lochore was no different. The beginning really starts with this famous chap, Robert the Burgundian, who's quite a character, who arrives on the scene in 1128, really as part of David I's push at that time to supplant many native lords with Anglo-Norman and French lords. And he really starts quite stushy locally. One of the largest legal disputes from the period is recorded with Robert basically annoying most of the ecclesiastical landowners in the area. But subsequent to that, his family does marry into the Earls of Fife, as his son marries the daughter of the Earl of Fife, Constantine, at the time. And the lords of Lochore are established from that basis. We've got a series of other families. I won't spend too much time on this because quite a lot to get through, but the Valance are a key name to remember, another northern French family established from the Wars of Independence in 1196. And it's often with these noble families, it's the failing of a male line which causes the transition. And the Valance, as they're often known, are no different in that their heiress in the early 15th century marries the ward lords of Torring and so on. It's likely the ward lords and the Valance who have established much of the tower that we see today. And in fact, until the 19th century, Robert the ward lord's name was inscribed above the main gate, which sadly has now collapsed. And as we move into the later history, we start to understand how the site has come to its state at the moment, in that the Malcolms set about abandoning the site, and by the 1710, Sybald records it as in ruins, and it Captain Park, who then takes possession of the estate, sets about essentially robbing the site, and he is the one who drains Lochore. So here's the site as it was. The original name, I should say, is Inchgall, which is Gaelic, of course, the island of the strangers. Here's been given in Ross's plan, done in the 1887, and it shows some of the main features today. As I said, a lot of the side walls have collapsed, so we've lost these. We really just have the corners. And a number of very interesting features recorded at this time, these artillery towers, as we think they are. So, back to what we've been doing. Geophysical surveys, the opening up of the site really allowed us to get in, and as you see, geophysical beginners. A lot of work with folk back in the winter last year, and we got some very useful results. So this is the resistivity. I'm not going to dwell on these too much because I presented some of these last year, I think, but it's really the physical evidence of. But suffice to say, this seems to be the beach of the island, and we managed to identify a number of high resistance spots to give us details of the structure. So here's our interpretive plan based on that. Note our tower foundations were identified and a number of features around the sides of the island. And this led us to select some trenches. Now, it's a scheduled monument, so the process really has to be informed by national research agendas, but there's also the health and safety element. The tower itself is a building at risk, so bringing volunteers to get stones falling on their head is not part of our aim. So we prioritised the perimeter of the site as our main area of interest. And one of the key questions about Lochore in my mind was, why is it on an island particularly? That's something normally associated, many of you know, with Celtic areas of lordship in Ireland, in Scotland and Wales. Cranrocks comes to mind, of course. And there are a few select examples of island-based castles in eastern Scotland, and its association with this large keep, one of the strongest castles in Fife in 1547, as it's recorded during the rough wooing of the English, is very significant. So we're trying to understand the interaction between native and incoming lords with our French. So here's French 8. We wanted to understand how the Barmkin Wall was constructed. Is it phased, etc.? We identified a highly wrought feature. This is the line of our main wall. It was single phase. But what was particularly interesting for us is we wanted to gain some access down to the lower deposits of the interior and the exterior. And we found a series of occupation deposits and demolition deposits overlying those here. And in the very base of it, the underlying everything and predating all of these layers was this massive layer of boulders. And this extended beyond the wall and down the slope and under a lot of mining clinker, which was a common feature throughout the site, because mining material was spread across the whole boundaries of the site. There was a lot to get through. This trench is associated with the sort of ubiquitous features of medieval sites, lots of oyster shells, building material and roofing slates. Here's our trench B. And this is it at the beginning. So they've got a slot through the wall with the corner where one of our towers were. So after a great deal of work, going through a lot of early 20th century material, it must be said, and some of the robbings likely from our friend Captain Park, we revealed the outline of the foundations of our tower. So here's our circular head of the tower. We've got the edges of a foundation leading towards the start of the wall. And there is an original facing here, which is where there was a postern, a little hidden gate around the corners of the tower. And we've got this massive layer of large basalt stones appearing again, some of which have been laid to create the foundation of the tower, but the great majority of them seem to make up the body of the island itself. And this seems to be a man-made layer, particularly interesting. But a great deal of the island surface material had been robbed, as you can see on this side. This is a closer in view. Just up here, a huge mass of rubble was removed, and this is the face of the wall. So we've got about two courses surviving, it's mortar bonded. And we've got this nice little find off the rubble. This is Sukili, one of our archaeology ambassadors who's been working with us. She's very pleased to find this carved masonry fragment, which appears to be quite small, but definitely a carved face here, curving edge, and mortared on the inside. So, placing this in context, here's McGivern and Ross's shop. This is where Sue found her stone, and it seems possible that this is part of a gunroom, the base of a gunroom, which is placed probably within the 15th century, maybe similar to the kind of fortification that you see at Three Castle, another island based site down in Dumfriesshire. Other finds of the trench, a nice little gaming piece, which variously, if this sample from Kent is right, probably 1600s onwards. Or if you take other authorities, they have a very long usage. They could be to knuckle bones even up to the 1800s. Nice little find for Cat McCulloch, one of our other volunteers. So in our trench C, which was positioned on the sort of edges of the island, which seemed to look like there was a cut feature here, which could be a harbour, we went through a mass of material, and suffice to say, so much so that it almost exhausted our volunteers. But they did a great job. But the reminder that this landscape has been filled with a lot of modern waste and bulldoze waste was certainly through the fight. We found a huge amount of dumped industrial material, including a lot of stuff that's very interesting to local mining community, hobnail boots, other machinery, just all dumped. And normally in our archaeological site, these would be perhaps less priority, but we're looking after them because they really represent the local community's immediate history. And we've got a mass of this material. It was the great deal of material that we found. So what did we get out of the stretch? We didn't get our harbour. We got the edge of the island itself, but it really gives the opportunity, once we did get down into the lower loch deposits, to do some paleo-environmental analysis. So up to a metre and a half down, we got down into the silts and clays of the loch itself. Lots of anthropomorphic material, hazelnut shells, and we've taken some thin section analysis there, and you know, this is the other context. Early days yet, we've got a lot of post-excavation work to do, but what we certainly hope to do is recreate the paleo-environmental landscape here. So what kind of vegetation was present, what kind of crops were being farmed in the local area. So this should be certainly a very fascinating story that unravels over the next year. Volunteers have been helping us with our post-excavation and certainly turning up a number of nice little finds. So for instance, lots of medieval pottery from the site, about 60 sheds. The small trenches we've had, that's pretty good. Probably in the span of time between the 12th to 15th centuries, although I'm sure Derek Paul will be giving us a detailed story on this soon. We also got quite a lot of interesting animal bones from the medieval layers. This little rhodia skull and butchered fragments of that reminding us of the lordly status of this residence. And window glass, as you can see, reminding us of the splendour of the building in its original form, this little piece of lead light, late medieval lead light. So the story doesn't end there with Loch Awe. It's been a small trial trench, giving people the opportunity to advance the story of the site. And I think as the post-excavation comes through, we certainly will have more surprises with our radiocarbon dates, particularly about the boundary layer, the boulder layer that you saw earlier. Will that tell us that this was an early medieval seat of power? Particularly interesting piece of research to be done. But the castle itself, if you go there today, it's under a lot of scaffolding at the moment. It's being conserved. The plan is that by the end of the project, we'll have it stabilised and this will be an accessible site for the first time for the local community in many years. And we've been hearing a lot of stories of people playing on it as a child and the like. So, you know, I think we should pat ourselves on the back as we go into year three, certainly. I'm going to show you just at the end some bits of details from our friend Mike Arrowsmith here. Slightly unconventional, we're going to drop out of my PowerPoint. I should say thanks to our funders, the National Lottery Fund, and to Historic Scotland, who funded this through their voluntary sector fund. But we thought we'd just take this last bit to show you some of the other photogrammetry work we've done. And it's quite an ambitious project that Mike's been working with throughout. And as he pans through, you can see that we've created a rather nice detailed record of the standing room prior to conservation. We had to remove a lot of the trees because that interrupted the model. But through a successive series of return visits by Mike and his friend Eddie Martin, both from St Andrews University, I think you'll agree they've created a fantastic record there. And we're going to get this put online on our website. So although people can't get onto the scaffolding at the moment, they can certainly visit the site in their minds at least. I think I'll end there, so I don't go over too far, and we've got some time for questions, but thank you very much for your time. I think I'll drop over there. Over to you, Eva. No? Thank you.